Barrett Kohler Publishers presents Breakthrough Community Change, a guide to creating common agendas that change everything. Written by Paul Bourne, narrated by Jeff Hoyt. Foreword. I have been waiting for Paul's latest book, Breakthrough Community Change, for some time now. Before he started writing the book, I had asked Paul to host a private webinar for the stewards and faculty of the Asset-Based Community Development, or ABCD, Institute, specifically to share the methodology he developed for large-scale community change. Paul's ideas are unique in that they have been tested in the real world and have had a dramatic impact, measurably improving communities throughout Canada, the United States, and around the world. Paul's work has improved the lives of thousands of people. The ideas and methodology that he perfected during his time at the Tamarack Institute have ended poverty for many people, given hope to young people for better futures, helped cities prepare for climate change, and deepened the experience of community, which in turn has reinforced citizenship in entire neighborhoods. Paul has been a faculty member, now known as a steward, of the ABCD Institute for several decades. The ABCD Institute is at the center of a large and growing global movement that considers local assets as the primary building blocks of sustainable community development. Building on the skills of local residents, the power of local associations, and the supportive functions of local institutions, asset-based community development draws upon existing community strengths to build stronger, more sustainable communities for the future. Paul and the Tamarack Institute, which he co-founded with philanthropist and business leader Alan Broadbent, have provided significant leadership in advancing the work of ABCD in Canada and beyond. In this audiobook, Paul provides practical and easy-to-follow steps that anyone can replicate to improve their neighborhoods and communities. He also provides exercises that can help citizens to collectively challenge their mental models and to work with people across sectors, embracing differences and recognizing diversity as an asset to celebrate as essential to creating solutions to some of the most pressing problems facing our communities. If you want to live in a better neighborhood, community, or city, listen to this audiobook. If you fear the future and need hope that large-scale positive change is possible, listen to this audiobook. If you are leading change in your community, I highly recommend using this audiobook as a guide to improve your outcomes. I listen to Paul Bourne when I want to know how people get together for the common good. He is a master practitioner and storyteller. If you want to know what lies beyond the radical individualism and collective incompetence that plague our modern lives, listen to this audiobook. John McKnight. John McKnight is co-founder of the Asset-Based Community Development Institute and a senior associate of the Kettering Foundation. He is the author of Associational Life and the Careless Society, and co-author of The Connected Community, Building Communities from the Inside Out, The Abundant Community, and An Other Kingdom. Introduction. Whole Community Change. Our world is facing pressing and relentless problems: climate change, poverty, disease, racism, and inequality are jeopardizing the lives and well-being of all citizens. We need meaningful breakthroughs to create large-scale, community-wide change. Incremental change will not provide the momentum needed to tackle these unyielding challenges. It is most important for us to work as a united force to innovate, cooperate, and collaborate if we are to achieve the breakthroughs needed to redress and make significant progress to improve the quality of life for all. Cities, towns, municipalities, neighborhoods, and communities are in a unique position to prioritize innovative approaches to achieve large-scale impact through breakthrough community change. These groups can act at a manageable scale to collaborate at a magnitude that can result in noteworthy changes within a defined geographic area. They can maximize breakthrough community change approaches to transform the root causes of social problems in their communities. As business, government, nonprofits, and people with lived or living experience gather to network and learn from each other, new and creative ideas emerge, and the momentum for change is fueled. This intense collaboration results in some of the most profound social changes, including ending poverty, reducing cancer rates, and becoming carbon neutral. In the end, the community is a better and more vibrant place for all. Breakthrough Community Change recognizes that we can do more together when we unite than any of us can do alone. By working toward a common agenda and with a common approach, we bring the unique skills and assets of each individual into the process of change. When we become an interconnected force, large-scale breakthrough community change is possible. I believe that many of the social issues and the brokenness we see and feel in our communities are felt by most of us. We see many different people struggle, including single parents, alienated families, young people, and many dealing with mental health issues. We see the effects of climate change, poverty, and racism on our neighbors. We are somehow frozen together like ice cubes that melted just enough to touch each other before they froze again. We want to act, but we are stuck, or maybe we are just waiting for a sign or an opportunity to act. And yet so often we wait and nothing changes. The world needs our discontent with the way things are. If we were content, we would accept the brokenness we see daily in our communities. We would accept the fear our children have of their future and climate change. We would accept the misery of the homeless mother struggling to care for her children and the fractious and seemingly futile struggle of people faced with racism and the inequity it breeds. We would accept the hunger pangs that are never satisfied, the workers that earn less than they need. Our discontent leads us and the organizations we work within to seek breakthroughs. Many of us have experienced breakthroughs that have changed our lives. We have had flashes of pure clarity and aha moments that seem to transform old ways of thinking, reinvigorate energies, and lead us to a new, more innovative way of living. Throughout this audiobook, you will hear stories about the breakthroughs of many individuals I have coached and mentored along their journey to engage an entire community and creating large-scale impact. The stories I share will illustrate how the power of personal and organizational breakthroughs can be harnessed at the community level to increase engagement, identify assets, and work collaboratively to build a common agenda and work toward whole community change. Many of us have been part of a team or group working in a community that has experienced a breakthrough. Community teams or groups usually have common goals and strive to work together to achieve an agreed-upon outcome. The best teams know how to engage creatively, challenge mindsets, and discover innovative ways of working together. This is the journey toward a community breakthrough. Breakthrough Community Change, a guide to creating common agendas that change everything, illustrates the process of communities collaborating to achieve large-scale change and makes the approaches, ideas, techniques, and skills available to a growing field of change makers. This audiobook presents a practical approach that can inspire community leaders and social service providers to consider solving the root causes of problems rather than simply addressing their symptoms or alleviating their effects. Part 1 of this audiobook will lead you through a process of identifying your community's readiness for change, forming leadership, action, and work teams, creating a common agenda, and establishing plans for community engagement, internal and external communication, shared measurement, and governance. These efforts lead to the implementation of a community campaign that can result in large-scale community change. Part 1 provides a roadmap to breakthrough community change. Essential to this journey is a common agenda. A common agenda is a result of building trust in new ways and forging a shared community commitment to the needed change. When people are committed to change, they bring forth individual and organizational assets that contribute to collective action. The process of developing a common agenda results in people being engaged, curious, and innovative. New creativity can be unleashed as people release old mental models and embrace collective ones. The process of building a common agenda unites a community and increases bonding across multiple sectors. A common agenda is the door that opens to breakthrough community change. Critical to the journey toward impact is asking broader questions and measuring and observing interventions and effects for the change we want to see. Listening to people with lived experience, learning quickly, and adapting are critical to moving toward a strong impact. Progress should be tracked using a contribution mindset rather than an attribution measurement approach. The evaluation process should be designed and carried out in ways that empower stakeholders and are organized around their questions. Part 2 of this audiobook provides more detailed descriptions of the approaches and skill sets, ideas and strategies, that can help you to develop the muscles needed to do the work described in Part 1. The most effective community changemakers have an evolving awareness or knowledge of theories and concepts around how communities function, how policies are developed, and how people are engaged in the process of change. Most importantly, they are interested in how communities collaborate and authentically work together to achieve better outcomes. Effective community collaboration is complex and draws from the study of collective impact, asset-based community development, community engagement, social innovation, collaborative leadership, and participatory evaluation. As founder and former CEO of the Tamarack Institute, I have worked with hundreds of communities as they worked through this process and made significant impacts on their community. One community I coached of over 100,000 people reduced decades of deeply entrenched poverty from 28% of the population down to 12%. I have seen the ideas shared in this audiobook contribute tremendously to large-scale change in communities. These changes transform the root causes of social problems and result in large-scale population-level impact. To achieve a population-level impact, we must recognize that the issues facing the community are radically interconnected. The deeper we understand and experience connections between each other and within the community, the more we will be able to uncover hidden resources and innovative ideas. When we unite within a network of committed individuals and agree on a common agenda for change, we move closer to comprehensive transformation and resolution of social and economic challenges. The goal of the Tamarack Institute is to better understand community change and make the work of community change leaders easier and more effective. The Institute works in Canada, the United States, and worldwide to advance communities collaborating for population-level change. The Institute's 42,000 active learners are leaders in the processes of large-scale community change. This audiobook is about sharing what we learned along the way and making the knowledge, processes, and strategies more accessible to a broader audience. This journey started when my colleagues and I launched Opportunities 2000, a 4-year campaign in the Waterloo region of Canada with the goal of reducing poverty in our community to the lowest level in the country by the year 2000. As the work intensified and positive changes were realized and supported by strong outcome data, word spread quickly. By 2022, nearly 500 communities in Canada and the United States joined together as a learning community called Vibrant Communities. These communities create common agendas and use the breakthrough community change ideas and practices described in this audiobook to end poverty, secure youth futures, support climate transition, and deepen a sense of community. With more than 1 million people out of poverty, almost all the communities in the Vibrant Communities Network have seen significant drops in poverty at the population level and improvements in the quality of life for all residents. Canada has reduced poverty dramatically. The 2000 poverty rate in Canada was 16.2%. Since the creation of Vibrant Communities, Statistics Canada reports the poverty rate has dropped to 6.4% in 2020, the lowest level of poverty in Canada's history. Collaborative community change is fueling worldwide change. Tamarack's Vibrant Communities uses the collaborative ideas and practices of breakthrough community change shared in this audiobook with multiple campaigns in Canada, the United States, and around the world. Communities Building Youth Futures is using the strategies to identify their goal of improving high school graduation rates and youth engagement. Community Climate Transitions has taken on the task of combating climate change. Cities Deepening Community uses these strategies to strengthen citizenship and advance neighborliness. More examples of the effectiveness of the integration of multiple ideas on community change are described throughout the audiobook. Like you, when I read the newspaper or scroll through social media, I am struck by how many reports detail significant problems in my neighborhood, country, and around the world. At times I feel like I am being bombarded with such massive and complex problems that I am paralyzed with despair. As a community organizer for many years, I know well how easy it is to be overwhelmed by issues of recession, poverty, loneliness, youth mental illness, climate crises, rising rates of disease, and so many other social problems. Yet I know that I cannot be still. I cannot be silent. I must use my knowledge, experience, and energies to champion changes that will build better, stronger, and healthier lives for people in our communities around the world. Part 1. Communities Collaborating. This audiobook is written as a guide for you to learn about building collaborative community change. The only right way to bring about change in your community is to find the way that works within your community's unique set of circumstances. I have found that once people get the idea of communities collaborating, they long to hear how other community leaders have done the work of large-scale change and use this information to fine-tune their own methodology. It is important to declare my bias and the bias of the Tamarack Institute when describing our kind of communities collaborating work. As a coach, I perceive and work with communities through a collective impact lens. I have used the ideas and practices of collective impact because I believe that it is the most advanced form of communities collaborating. Rather than simply collaborating to improve how organizations and communities work together, collective impact calls us to seek large-scale, population-level impacts. This has been important to the campaigns Tamarack has supported. If you are unfamiliar with collective impact, Chapter 13 provides you with a summary of this methodology. Even though I have a collective impact bias, I also share the ideas of many thought leaders and approaches. This audiobook seeks to more generally consider approaches to communities collaborating, with only one of the approaches being collective impact. My approach has been influenced by people that I consider mentors. Margaret Wheatley was my earliest influence when she released Leadership and the New Science. This book introduced me to systems change thinking and helped me see how community issues are integrated. I was also attracted to considering simpler ways of organizing groups of people, as Wheatley described so beautifully in her book, A Simpler Way. David Crislip is a pioneer in the work of collaborative leadership. His books, Collaborative Leadership, How Citizens and Civic Leaders Can Make a Difference, and the Collaborative Leadership Field Book, transformed how I understand leadership. Crislip is interested in the attributes and the skill sets of collaborative leaders. His work inspired me to believe that collaborative community change could be taught and learned. I now understand how collaborative leadership is distinct from leadership development training. Ann Kubisch was the director of the Aspen Institute's Roundtable on Community Change, which supports community development in disadvantaged communities. She published the Roundtable series Voices from the Field 1, 2, and 3, which provides a comprehensive state-of-the-field analysis of community change initiatives. The Roundtable pioneered work in evaluating community initiatives and was integral in advancing the theory of change approach to planning. They pioneered work on structural racism. In many ways, far ahead of her time, Anne and her team influenced how we understand outcomes and provide practical approaches for communities collaborating to create systemic change. The White House Council for Community Solutions, initiated by First Lady Michelle Obama and President Barack Obama, with support from Melody Barnes, assistant to President Obama and director of the Domestic Policy Council, was mandated to identify key attributes of effective community-developed solutions to our national problems. As part of this effort, the Domestic Policy Council worked to build capacity within communities to establish collaboratives for creating broad-based change. My interest was piqued when the Council released the Community Collaborative Toolbox. Later, the Council came out to endorse collective impact, a process for community change most significantly advanced by Jennifer Splansky-Juster, John Kania, Mark Kramer, and their colleagues at FSG. Melody Barnes left the White House to support the advancement of collective impact through the Aspen Institute's Forum for Community Solutions and to start the Opportunity Youth Forum. This work convinced me that the work of communities collaborating was entering a sort of golden age. Many more communities want to expand their knowledge and understanding of this approach to social change. The Tamarack Institute has been the proving ground for many of the approaches described in this audiobook. My thinking and work have been significantly influenced by longtime colleagues Liz Weaver and Mark Cabage, Lisa Ottega, Sylvia Chu, Allison Homer, Heather Keem, Laura Schnur, Natalie Blanchett, and Miriam Birubi are noteworthy colleagues who have contributed to and expanded my thinking on community change. I share these names because the field surrounding communities collaborating is growing. There are many thought leaders in this space. Although I am sharing my way, so many parts of the approach I am sharing represent our way of teaching community change at Tamarack. To learn more and to receive many practical tools, go to tamarackcommunity.ca. Chapter 1, Breakthrough Community Change. But we know for sure that these are days when the improbable can become the inevitable. Jim Dwyer, New York Times, October 25, 2014. A guide to rethinking your motivation to help, embracing root problem solutions, and moving from incremental to large-scale change. I sense that you are listening to this audiobook because you want more for your community. Like me, you realize that even though there is so much amazing work being done by such amazing and dedicated people, the problems just seem to be getting worse. You hope that we might solve the issues that are causing people to suffer. You want real change. You are looking for a breakthrough. Breakthrough community change is recognizing that we can do more together when we unite our community than any of us can do individually. By working toward a common agenda and with a common approach, we bring the unique skills and assets of each individual into the process of change. When we become an interconnected force, large-scale breakthrough community change is possible. I came to community work because I wanted to help people. My instinct is to just jump in and help. I help as a caring citizen, whether it is holding open a door, cooking at a soup kitchen, organizing my neighborhood's parties, or supporting a friend going through a health crisis. I help people as a professional counselor, job trainer, administrator, community organizer, and small business coach. I want to share a favorite childhood story of mine that describes my earliest motivation for helping others. The shore was littered with thousands of starfish that had washed up. A young boy was standing near the water, throwing them back into the ocean. A passerby approached the boy and asked, "Why are you throwing the starfish back into the sea? Do you not realize that this is futile?" The boy reached down and picked up another starfish, threw it into the water, and said, "At least I helped this one." I was inspired by the resilience of that little boy. I identified with him. His answers motivated me to keep working to help people, despite the seemingly overwhelming problems that were rarely resolved. I did not question the boy's answer about helping just one. I will never lose my instinct to help even just one person. I have, though, come to realize that to truly help people in need, we must create the conditions to address the root problem they face. My mentor and thesis advisor, Joe Schaefer, shared his wisdom with me when I told him of my desire to end poverty in my community. He said, "If you want to end poverty, you should ask those who care and possibly those who do not these questions. How might we create a community in which poverty could not exist? How then would we live within and with each other?" His response had a profound effect on me. It solidified my thinking, changed my understanding, and fueled my desire to address the root cause of poverty. My focus shifted from wanting to alleviate poverty to ending poverty. In other words, to shift the work from simply helping the poor live better lives to creating systems that would end poverty. Today, if I were that boy standing on the beach confronting this overwhelming problem, the first thing I would do is run to the nearest village and organize the villagers to join me in working together to save as many starfish as we could. Once everyone was well organized and committed to saving the starfish that had washed up on the shore, I would host community conversations that would consider why all these starfish were stranded. I would seek the wisdom of the helpers. We would form an action team, climb into a boat, paddle out to sea, and try to find the source of the problem. Once we better understood what was going on, we would develop a plan to save the starfish. Then we would mobilize the community to enact the plan. With this united agenda, we would work together to achieve a collective impact, mobilizing the whole community and saving as many starfish as possible. My breakthrough. I have always trusted community. As a young boy, I grew up in a community of refugees who survived the terrible traumas of war and famine in their homeland of Ukraine. Both of my grandfathers had been executed during the purge of Stalin. As a family and a community of refugees, we survived and then thrived through what I like to call a hive mind, where we worked and learned together. We made sense of the world together through our collective intelligence. Almost no one was unemployed in our community. If you lost your job, it was our community that helped make connections for you to find a new one. When we wanted to expand our farms, we talked to our neighbors. One neighbor learned how to grow raspberries, and soon we all grew them. Visiting after church services was as much a peer-to-peer business conversation as it was a social one. It was common to hear conversations where advice was readily shared. One neighbor would ask, "How did you say you prepared the raspberries for winter?" And others would chime in with their ideas. We were an interconnected community. We worked together utilizing this hive mind to improve outcomes. These early experiences shaped my approach to community change. Many years later, I was standing at the lectern, nervously shuffling my papers and waiting for the applause to subside. Nicholas Yu, then senior policy and planning advisor at UN Habitat, had arrived in Waterloo, Canada from Nairobi. He was here to give the Community Opportunities Development Association, or CODA, a United Nations Habitat for Best Practice Top 40 Award for our work with poverty reduction in the Waterloo region of Canada. As executive director of CODA, I was accepting the award. I should have felt proud, but instead I felt conflicted. There were hundreds of people in the room, waiting to be inspired by my remarks. All I could think was, do we deserve this recognition? My remarks began with the standard thank yous to the dignitaries in the room, the staff and volunteers who had worked so hard, and the partner organizations that had supported our success. I went on to share about the remarkable team that supported more than 5,000 individuals and families to improve their economic security and raise themselves out of poverty. Our team supported people getting back to work, starting small businesses, and finding work after being displaced because of numerous factory closures. We helped thousands of families with children living in poverty by providing books for birthdays and hosting an annual Christmas party. Our results were outstanding. Nearly 82% of the business startups we supported were still active after 5 years. The plant closure team successfully placed more than 90% of all the workers who had been displaced into new jobs. We had created a total community response to the problem of unemployment. United Nations Habitat wanted to spread the word about our work by giving us the award. I had opened my speech the way most had expected, but then I paused. Through an uncomfortable silence, I looked up from my notes and surveyed our supporters in the audience. I closed my notepad, drank some water, and slowly began to speak. "I find it interesting that we are being honored today," I said. "Of course, I am proud of the work we have done and the successes I have shared with you. But I am also perplexed, or maybe a better word is confused. You see, I get it that our outcomes are remarkable when compared to everyone else doing similar work in our community and beyond. I also understand that we have created a unique approach to helping unemployed people, and this should be recognized. But here is my dilemma. Even after all the success we accomplished over the past 10 years, poverty has increased by nearly 5% in our community. That means things are getting worse for unemployed people. Things have gotten worse in our community and not better. I sense that when poverty increases in a community, it is like a business losing shareholder wealth. When you lose significant shareholder wealth, you get fired, not recognized. So you see, I do not think we should accept this award today." As you can imagine, these comments did not go over so well with the audience. Nicholas Yu got up after me and shared with the audience that we were being recognized not only for our remarkable work, but also for creating what he called a human problem-solving machine. He went on to say that the broader outcomes, such as our unemployment rate, were subject to so many outside influences that are beyond our control. The audience agreed with him. And despite my moment of confusion, we received our award. My struggle with accepting the award was well-founded. Mark Cabage, a promising student at the time, had approached me to host an internship for him. I was immediately taken by his sharp mind and discontent from the current state of communities in Canada. He had just returned from working in Europe, where he supported businesses and social development and witnessed the fall of the Berlin Wall. Mark had grown up on a small farm in rural Alberta. He has become one of the foremost experts in the field of development evaluation and is called on around the world for his knowledge of community change. Mark convinced me that CODA should do a cost-benefit analysis and consider the opportunity costs of the work we were doing to determine where we should invest our energy and money to achieve the greatest impact. We brought together some of the best and brightest people and community leaders to form an advisory council. Members of the advisory council included Mike Lewis of the New Economy Development Group, Robin Murray from the London School of Economics, and other local community leaders. The goal of the advisory council was to provide feedback on the work of our organization and give insight into our work going forward. They concluded that even though CODA ran exceptional programs, its real benefit was that it had created new ways of working together as a community. They emphasized that we created a systems change approach to our work. The advisory council highlighted that all of CODA's services address the needs of individuals through transactional engagements and simultaneously sought to address a larger community problem by drawing on the existing assets of the community. The advisory council felt we had a remarkable ability to turn everything we did into a campaign. We organized a whole community response.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.